الحمد لله ثم الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن سيدنا محمد عبده ورسوله وصفيه وخليله أرسله بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله وكفى بالله شهيدا ونشهد أن آدم خليفة الله وأن نوح نجي الله وأن إبراهيم خليل الله وأن موسى كليم الله وأن عيسى بن مريم روح الله وكلماته صلوات الله وسلامه عليهم أجمعين ومن بينهم من النبيين والمرسلين قال الله تعالى في كتابه العزيز بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما We begin my respected elders, my brothers and my sisters in faith and humanity, praising and thanking Allah, the creator of all that is, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the sustainer of all that is, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one who's given everything and everyone their balance and their equilibrium and their guidance. He is the one subhanahu wa ta'ala who we declare that there's nothing worth worship but Him, and that our leader, our master, our beloved guide and teacher, Muhammad, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, may God bless his beautiful soul, his spirit, and grant him peace, is his last and final prophet, last and final messenger to all human beings. The black of them and the white of them, the brown of them and the yellow of them and the red of them, and we declare that whomever Allah Ta'ala guides, none can lead astray. And whomever Allah allows to go astray, none can guide. And we bear witness that Adam is the vicegerent of God, and that Noah was the one rescued by God, and that Moses is the one that God spoke directly to, and that Abraham is the intimate, beloved friend of God, and that Jesus, the son of the Blessed Mary, is the spirit, the created spirit of God, and a word from him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, O humanity, indeed we created you from a single soul, from the two of them, and from it created its mate. And from the two of them dispersed multitudes of men and women. Be reverent of Allah. Be reverent of God. Be conscious of God and the wombs that bore you. Indeed, Allah sees all that you do. O you who have faith, be conscious of God, be reverent of God as He should be shown reverence. O you who have embodied faith, be conscious of God and speak truthfully. Speak honestly. And if you do this, Allah will forgive your sins and rectify all your affairs. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whoever obeys Allah and His messenger has attained the greatest success. My dear respected elders, brothers and sisters, today I want to talk about going back to basics, going back to the qawaid, the principles of this beautiful, this perfect, this complete deen, this way of life. The principles of good and evil, the foundations of good and evil, Allah gives them to us in the Quran. And I want us to just take a few minutes in this Jumu'ah to remind ourselves and to reflect on the meanings of one ayah. This is the ayah that most of the khatibs, most of the preachers end their khutbah with. But today I want us to make the khutbah about the ayah that most khatibs end their khutbah with. We have a checkered history as Muslims. We have times in our history that were very glorious, very brilliant moments of the manifestation of what's best in the human soul, what's best in the human mind, what's best in our character. But then we also have moments in our history that are very tragic, very sad. Sometimes we like to whitewash and skip over this history. Unfortunately, we should not. We should be honest. We should be authentic. We should not just be concerned with the authenticity of hadith. We should be concerned with the authenticity of our history and the authenticity of ourselves. We should be authentic human beings. And one step towards becoming an authentic person is facing your past, facing your history. And we had a time in our history when, unfortunately, during the khutbah, the government required that the family of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam be maligned, be insulted, be cursed. Until the great leader, the great Sultan Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, changed this practice. He changed this practice because he knew that it was not a practice that was from the Quran or the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which calls us to honor the family of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. See, this is what happened when government and religion, when government uses religion for its own ends and means. And he decreed, and he made this institutional change, that at the end of the khutbah, the imam should say, rather, بَدْعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَعْمُرُ بِالْعَدْلِ وَالْإِحْسَانِ وَإِيتَاءِ ذِي الْقُرْبَى وَيَنْهَى عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنكَرِ وَالْبَغْيِ يَعِظُكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَذَكَّرُونَ. Indeed, God orders, God commands to justice and spiritual beautification, kindness, generosity, and generosity with your relatives. And he obeys, he forbids and condemns lewdness, indecency, transgression, and rebellion. And he exhorts you in order that you might take heed. And it is from this time that it became the convention of the Muslim Ummah, of the Muslim nation, to end the khutbahs with this ayah from Surah An-Nahl, the chapter of the bee, ayah 90. Now, before this ayah, in ayah 89, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَنَزَّلْنَا عَلَيْكَ الْكِتَابِ تِبْيَانًا لِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ. And we send down upon you the scripture, and it is an explanation of all things. The commentators say that this ayah preceding the command to justice and spiritual beauty and generosity with family members is not, of course, it's the Quran. It's not just a coincidence. Nothing in the Quran is coincidental. Nothing in life is coincidental. Everything is in its proper place because it has been placed there by Al-Hakim, the All-Wise, Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. Allah mentions, وَنَزَلْنَا عَلَيْكَ الْكِتَابِ تِبْيَانًا لِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ. We've sent upon you, we've revealed upon you the book as an explanation for all things. And then in the next ayah, Allah gives you the principles for a happy life, the principles for success, The principles for a family, for a neighborhood, for a city, for a country, for yet even a civilization, to be successful by anyone's standard, not just according to the measures of religious people, by anyone's standard. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also gives in the same ayah, the 19th ayah of Surah Al-Na'al, the principles that lead to the destruction, that lead to the atrophy and deterioration of families and neighborhoods and nations and civilizations. There are three principles that are the foundations of all good and three principles that are the foundation of all evil. These are al-adl. The first is justice. And this beautiful word, adl, is of course one of the names of Allah Ta'ala. Al-Adl is one of Allah's beautiful names. These names that we call upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to connect the hearts to Allah. That's why we are here, to connect our hearts in this world with our Creator. So that when we are in the masjid, or when we are at our businesses, or at our jobs, or in our homes, or when we are on the playgrounds, our hearts are constantly connected with Allah Ta'ala, so that we can be like the companions who it was said about them, their feet were on the earth while their hearts were connected to the hereafter. These are the kind of people we want to be. People that are practical and pragmatic. People that are rational. But our hearts are connected to a place that is beyond the physical, that is beyond the rational even. The human being brings together these two different dimensions. And this is what qualifies us to be the Khalifa of Allah. إِنِّي جَاعِلٌ لِلْأَرْضِ Khalifa. Allah says to the angels, I'm placing in the earth a Khalifa. Because Allah did not say He's creating from the earth, He's placing in the earth. Because you, human being, your essence is not from this earth. Your essence is not from this earth. Your body is not your essence. Your body is from this earth. But that's not the essence of who you are. Your essence is the ruh that Allah created, that responded, Bala, indeed, when Allah asked, Alastu bi Rabbikum. That is who you are. That is who you were before your mother gave birth to you. Before you were African American, before you were Pakistani or Arab or Malay or Syrian or British or French or Chinese, you were a spirit. And the spirit has no ethnicity. The spirit has no color. The spirit has no gender. The spirit transcends gender. The spirit does not get old. The spirit does not get sad or angry. That's why the more we're connected to our spiritual self, the more happy you become. The more content you become. The more patient you become. The more giving you become, and the more forgiving you become. And these principles that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in Surah Al-Nahl in the 90th ayah, Al-Adl, Al-Adala, Wal-Ihsan, Wal-Ita', moderation, justice, spiritual beauty, and liberality, generosity, are meant to bring the body and the mind of a human being back in alignment with the spirit. And when your body and your mind and your soul, when the jasad and the nafs and the qalb and the aql, the intellect, are in line with the spirit, you have happiness, you have harmony, you have safety, you have security, you have growth, you have life, you have prosperity, you have elevation, and you have transcendence. One day, Ibn Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Abbas, may Allah Ta'ala be pleased with him, he says, in a hadith that's narrated by Imam al-Wahidi, who has a well-known book on the Asbab al-Nuzul, the history of revelation, he gives us about 600 or more ayat, and when the context in the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when these ayat were revealed. He says, one day Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was in Mecca. He was in Mecca. And he was sitting in the courtyard of his blessed house. And Uthman ibn Mad'un, Sayyiduna Uthman ibn Mad'un, he had not become Muslim yet. He was walking by. This was in Mecca. The Muslims were very few. Even after 13 years in Mecca, the numbers of the Muslims, according to our historians, didn't exceed 200. Would you call that success? 13 years, just over 100 followers? In the eyes of Allah, that was success. Because those muhajirun who first made hijrah to East Africa twice, and then made hijrah to Yathrib, that became Medina Nabi, Medina to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they were the seeds that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala crafted in order to plant the tree of Islam in Medina. And it is that tree of Islam that we are all the fruit of today. Just between 100 and 200 seeds. That was success. It is not about quantity, but quality. That is what's most important. So he smiled at the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He smiled at him. And the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam responded, "Ala tajlis, would you not sit down? Sit down." And they began to talk. And while they were talking, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam all of a sudden looked up at the heavens. For a while, Uthman ibn Mad'un radiallahu anhu, he's not Muslim yet. He sees this. He looks up at the heavens, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and then he looks down to the right. And then he turns away from Uthman and he starts talking as if he's trying to understand something. And then he looks back up at the heavens again and he fixes his gaze on the heavens. And then he continues talking to Uthman. Uthman is he's looking at what's going on. He says, "Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you did something today I've never seen you do before." The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as if he was oblivious to Uthman even being there, he says, "What did you see me do?" He said, "What did you see me do?" And then he described, "I saw you look up in the heavens, I saw you look down to the right, I saw you turn away." He said, Jibril came to me while you were sitting there. Look at how the Prophet wasallam was absorbed in receiving wahi. Receiving wahi is not a small thing. It's a difficult thing. It's something that took him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, beyond this world. He did not see Jibreel alayhi salam. On some occasions, the companions saw Jibreel alayhi salam, as we know. And then he said, "And what did the angel say to you?" And he recited the verse, "Inna Allah ya'mur bil adli wal ihsan wa ita'i dhil qurba wa yanha 'anil fahsha'i wal munkar wal baghi ya'idukum la'allakum tadhakkarun." And Uthman ibn Mad'un said, إِذَا حِين إِسْتَقَرَّ الْإِيمَانِ فِي قَلْبِهِ. He said, at that instant, when the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam recited that ayah, he said, "Iman settled in my heart. إِسْتَقَرَّ الْإِيمَانِ فِي قَلْبِهِ." Iman took up residence. Istakarra It means to take up residence somewhere. Iman took up residence in my heart. You see, Iman must come into our hearts. Islam is something that we must enter into. Udkhulu fi silmi kafa. You enter into surrender, into submission, into peace entirely, not half-heartedly. Don't do this deen half-baked. For your own sake, not for the benefit of Allah. Allah does not need us to worship Him. Udkhulu fi silmi kafa. Enter into Islam completely for your own benefit, for the benefit of your family, of your community, of your country. And don't follow the footsteps of the devil. And then he said, "Wa ahbabtu Muhammadan sallallahu alayhi wasallam." He said at that moment, "Fidalika al-heen, istaqara iman fi qalbi wa ahbabtu Muhammadan sallallahu alayhi wasallam." At that moment, iman took up residence. Iman moved into my heart. Iman has to move into your heart, and that is a gift from Allah Ta'ala. Islam, the practice of this deen, is a preparation for iman entering into the heart, taking up residence in our hearts. And in that entrance of iman into the heart is the prelude for the mahabba of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, for the love of the Messenger of God sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That is what made the sahaba sahaba. It is what made the companions companions. وَقُولُوا قَوْلِي هَذَا وَاسْتَغْفِرُوا لِي وَلَكُمْ وَلِسَائِرِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ وَاسْتَغْفِرُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ ثُمَّ الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ نَحْمَدُ وَنَسْتَعِينُ وَنَسْتَغْفِرُ وَنَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنْ شُرُورِ أَنْفُسِنَا وَمِنْ سَيِّئَاتِ أَعْمَالِنَا. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن سيدنا محمد عبده ورسوله. So in conclusion, my beloved brothers and sisters, my beloved elders, Islam revolves around these three principles. Success for any human being, even if they're not Muslim, revolves around these three principles. Al-Adl is our commitment to fairness and moderation. We don't go towards ifrats and we don't go towards tafrits. We don't go through extremism in practice or extremism in laxity. And the thing about extremists is that no extremist thinks they're extreme. Every extremist believes they're moderate. But how do you know if someone's an extremist? How do you know if you're an extremist? When we look at the maqasid al-sharia, we look at the objectives of sacred law. When the way you are practicing Islam leads to people leaving Islam, you're an extremist. And we have some communities that are like that. We have some masajid that are like that. We have some Islamic centers and Islamic schools that are like that. That people, they're driving people away from Islam. You are an extremist when the way you're practicing Islam endangers life or endangers the well-being of others. These are empirical. You can measure this. You're an extremist if the way you practice Islam causes the wealth of others, the property does harm or damage to the property of others or to the mental stability of others, or to the lineage and to the family stability of others, or to the reputation of others, because these maqasid are a human right. They're human right. So we seek to establish justice. This is what adl, we just talk about adl. Adl is that we establish justice, beginning with our own selves. That you start being just with your own body, with your own mind and your own soul. And then you bring justice into your family. You can't be just. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wasallam, he said that we should even show justice between our children. If you kiss one, kiss the others. You can't demand justice from your president or your king or your manager or the CEO, and then you're not just in your own house. There has to be a correlation. Justice. Malik Shabazz, Malcolm X, rahmatullah alayh, he said, I am for truth, no matter who says it. I don't care who says it. If it's true, I accept. I don't care if they're black or white. I don't care if they're Muslim or atheist. I don't care what they call themselves, what jama'ah or what minhaj or what madhab they follow. If they're speaking the truth, we have to accept. And he said, I am for justice, no matter who it is for or against. I'm not impartial. I'm not partial to people that look like me or that pray like me. Or we enact exact justice on the poor, but we need the rich who can get the good lawyers and find the loopholes. That's not justice. We need to establish justice. Allah commands to justice. Allah commands the prophets to justice. In fact, our scholars say, and we'll end here with these two points, that a country, a civilization that is just will have longevity, even if it is not Muslim. It will be prosperous, even if it is not Muslim. But a country that is corrupt, a country that is full of graft and bribery and under the table deals, decisions being made in smoke-filled rooms, will be short-lived. This is a principle, a cosmic divine principle. And that's why you see the countries in the world that are the most just. You see, in our world today, most countries have a mixture. There's Allah knows best if there's any country that's completely just. Maybe there are a few, we hope, inshallah ta'ala. But you know that the countries that are the most fair, that treat their citizens the most fairly and the most just, those are the countries where there's the most safety and the most security and the most prosperity. And the countries that are the most corrupt, This is where you see the most insecurity. This is where you see the most death and disease. Lastly, the scholars, our commentators say that al-adl, justice, relates to fulfilling hukuk, giving rights. Giving rights to those to whom rights are due. And there are two types of beings to which we owe rights. There's Al-Khaliq, the creator, and Makhluq, and the creation. So justice is not only about human rights, which is what the narrative, the discourse that we hear, but justice is also about the divine right. And Allah's right is that we believe in Him without any partner, and that we worship Him without any partner, and that we call on Him, and that we recognize that He is the everlastingly eternal, and that He, subhanahu wa ta'ala, has absolute control over this dunya and everything and everyone in it. And so, my dear beloved Muslims, do not despair. We may have a new leader this year or that year. The seasons may change. The climate may change, but there's only one Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as long as your heart is connected to Allah, and as long as you are open to Allah's guidance, we will always know what right course of action to take, what just course of action to take, and what compassionate course of action to take in service to Allah and in service to all human beings. اللهم اغفر للمسلمين والمسلمات والمؤمنين والمؤمنات الأحياء منهم والأموات اللهم أحسن عاقبتنا في الأمور كلها وأجرنا من خزي الدنيا وعذاب الآخرة إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد كما صليت على سيدنا إبراهيم وعلى آل سيدنا إبراهيم، وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد كما باركت على سيدنا إبراهيم وعلى آل سيدنا إبراهيم في العالمين، إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم أرض عن أصحاب رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم، اللهم وفقنا لما تحب وترضى، اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه، وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه. Oh Allah, we ask that you show us the truth as truth and give us the ability to follow it, and show us falsehood as falsehood and give us the ability to avoid. Oh Allah, bless these men, bless these women, Ya Allah, bless these children beyond their greatest imaginations, Ya Allah. Drive to them every good and every abundance and every safety and every security, Ya Allah. Oh Allah, make us among those who are grateful. We ask that you grant us paradise, Ya Allah, without reckoning and judgment, Ya Rabbal Alameen. Oh Allah, we pray that you give healing to our sick, that you have mercy upon our deceased, and that you free those who are in bondage, Ya Allah. Oh Allah, we ask that you accept this Jumu'ah. Inna Allah ya'malu bil adli wal ihsan wa ita'i dhul qurba wa yanha 'anil fahsha'i wal munkari wal baghi ya'idukum la'allakum tadhakkarun. ولذكر الله أكبر والله يعلم ما تصنعون. أقيم الصلاة.